You're listening to the audio production of 365 Devotions for a Thankful Heart, published by Zondervan and read by Suzie Althens.
January 1st. Awakening Gratitude. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. Psalm 95, verse 6. A quick step to a thankful heart is to spend a few minutes worshiping God. Open your Bible and read aloud a favorite psalm, Philippians chapter 2, or any favorite passage. Sing a classic hymn. Thank God for evidence of His presence. Another idea. In your journal, share your reaction to Brother Lawrence's thoughts on worship. To worship God in truth is to recognize Him for being who He is, and to recognize ourselves for what we are. To worship God in truth is further to admit that we are entirely contrary to Him, and that He is willing to make us like Himself if we desire it. We must worship Him by a humble and true adoration of spirit in the depth and center of our souls. Brother Lawrence, a 17th century monk, was the author of The Practice of the Presence of God, in which these and other thoughts about worship are found. The book's very title seems synonymous with the psalmist's call to worship the King, and spending time in worship awakens gratitude in our hearts. Father, You alone are worthy of worship, and I praise You for helping me know that joyful truth. January 2nd. At work behind the scenes. A man's heart plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9. Have you ever had to make a decision and then watch the situation turn out better than you'd hoped? Consider a couple of examples. The worship leader needed a substitute singer in half an hour. He wasn't sure why Haley came to mind, but he was confident she was the one he should call. Haley had just been turned down for the lead in the school musical, and now she was the worship leader's first choice. The temp agency sent many possible hires to the human resources department. One of them, Brenda, had been interviewing at various businesses and sensed God telling her to accept the first offer that came. Before he interviewed people for the position, the decision maker in HR had prayed for guidance, and he was the first to offer Brenda a job. Now, another believer brings God's light and grace to that company. When we realize that the Lord has worked behind the scenes, let's be quick to thank Him. Hindsight offers many reasons to grow in gratitude. I am grateful, Lord, for the hope and peace-giving truth that You are at work in my life. January 3rd. God's Rhythm. The seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work. Exodus chapter 20, verse 10. Are you someone who reads the instructions before you start assembling the bike or the bookcase? Paying attention to what manufacturers have to say about what they've made is a good thing. In the command to rest from Exodus, the fourth of the Ten Commandments, we see a basic rhythm God wove into His creation. 6 days of work followed by a day of rest. How could we regret setting apart that one day to rest and let God reorient, redirect, recharge, and refresh us? After all, when we do so, we are living according to the manufacturer's specifications. Sometimes, though, a manufacturer doesn't address every situation that might arise. Many of us have learned, for instance, that turning off our computers or smartphones for a few minutes and then restarting them can override a glitch, and we're good to go. But you and I are far more complex than any computer or smartphone. Let's be thankful that God knows how important it is for us to turn off, to slow down, to rest, so He can reset us for use again in His kingdom work. God has given us the instructions. All we have to do is follow them. Thank you, Lord, for wanting to bless me with rest. Please give me the discipline to choose your rhythm for my life. January 4th. Whistle while you work. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 12 through 13, New International Version. If you have watched Disney's classic film, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, you probably know the song, Whistle While You Work. Even if you've never heard it, the song's title is self-explanatory, and the lyrics flesh out its idea of choosing joy even while performing mundane tasks. Snow White made it look simple, but this mindset takes effort. It is all too easy to grumble and complain while working, whether you're sweeping up your child's Cheerios for the millionth time, sitting through a long meeting, studying for a big exam, or working long hours to finish a project. But when we gripe, we often find feelings of negativity following us for the rest of the day. If we decide to adopt a positive attitude or choose to figuratively whistle while working, we'll find life much more enjoyable. Consider whistling through work today, in whatever form is helpful to you. Listen to your favorite song to start your day. Savor your coffee during a tough drive to the office. Remind yourself of the good that's coming from your work, whether it's a clean and peaceful home, a paycheck to feed your family, or a step closer to your degree. Don't grumble. Whistle. Father, please remind me to choose a lighthearted response to the mundane tasks of the day. January 5th, the author and sustainer of life. God, who made the world and everything in it, gives to all life, breath, and all things. Acts chapter 17, verses 24 through 25. Aren't you glad that God did not create the world and walk away, as some people believe? Deists, for instance, don't question God's existence, and they give him total credit for creation. But they don't believe God is involved in his creation. God is, so to speak, the clockmaker who wound the clock and left the room. What a sharp contrast to the biblical truth that God is not only the author, but the sustainer of life. Job's friend, Elihu, acknowledged that the breath of the Almighty gives me life. Job chapter 33, verse 4. A psalmist recognized God's power over life and death. You take away their breath. They die and return to their dust. Psalm 104, verse 29. And the Levites in Nehemiah's day praise God for maintaining life. You alone are the Lord. You have made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their host, the earth and everything on it, the seas and all that is in them, and you preserve them all. Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 6. Let's thank God for giving us the air we need to breathe and the food we need to survive, for keeping our hearts beating and our lungs filling with air. Most of all, let's thank Him for loving His creation enough to be involved rather than walking away. Thank you for being intensely interested in your creation, in my life. Teach me to live with an awareness of your faithful involvement. January 6th, called and empowered. Go, and I will teach you what you shall say. Exodus chapter 4, verse 12. Any parent, anyone interviewing for a job, any teacher, any pastor, perhaps anyone on this planet, can thank God that when He calls us to do something, He empowers us to do it. Though Moses protested, I am not eloquent, I am slow of speech and slow of tongue, Exodus chapter 4, verse 10. In today's verse, we see God specifically promising that He will help Moses and tell him what to say to Pharaoh. God's power is available to us, but receiving it requires faith. We must open ourselves to receive His promises. God gave Moses a specific promise for a specific situation. But rather than responding in faith, Moses said to God, "Oh, my Lord, please send by the hand of whomever else you may send." Verse 13. God granted Moses' request and bestowed his brother, Aaron, with the ability, strength, and words to speak to Pharaoh. We miss out if, like Moses, we ask God to find someone else to do what he has called us to do. We are blessed when we, like Aaron, yield ourselves to God's plan, open ourselves to his power, and experience his using us in his kingdom work. Thank you, Lord, for assigning certain tasks and roles to me. When I hesitate to obey, help me rally my courage to forge ahead. January 7th. Knowing, loving, trusting. Be still and know that I am God. Psalm 46, verse 10. Sometimes revisiting a familiar truth can help us be thankful throughout the day. In Psalm 46, for instance, God calls us to stillness for a specific reason: to know Him. What are we to know about our God? British theologian and pastor John Gill said this: "No, own and acknowledge that He is God, a sovereign being that does whatsoever He pleases, that He is unchangeable in His nature, purposes, promises, and covenant, that He is omnipotent, able to help them and deliver them at the last extremity, that He is omniscient, knows their persons, cases, and troubles, and how and where to hide them till the storm is over, that He is the all-wise God, and does all things after the counsel of His own will, and makes all things work together for good to them, and that He is faithful to His word and promise, and will not suffer them to be overpressed and bore down with troubles." The more we know about God, the more readily we can trust Him and love Him. When we revisit the truth that stillness can help us know our God, we can be thankful for His accessibility in our silence before Him. Lord, help me pursue greater knowledge of You, so that I may love You better. January 8th. A tone of thanksgiving. I love the Lord, because He has heard my voice and my supplications, because He has inclined His ear to me. Therefore, I will call upon Him as long as I live. Psalm 116, verses 1 through 2. Take another look at these two verses from Psalm 116. Though not one key word about gratitude, thanks, thankfulness, grateful, appears here, the tone of thanksgiving is unmistakable. The proclamation, "I love," implies gratitude and communicates joy. The writer celebrates the reason for this love: because He has heard my voice and my supplications. The vow to call upon Him as long as I live also reflects this speaker's thankfulness for the way God hears and answers. Even without the word thanks, these verses communicate gratitude. Do our lives do the same? Put differently, what do the ways we carry ourselves, speak, and communicate using facial expressions and body language suggest about our attitude toward life? Is it clear we're grateful people? Consider what retooling your attitude might need. Of course, the tone of our lives alone cannot sufficiently express our gratitude to God or to the people in our world. But when our actions indicate a thankful heart, the words we speak ring truer. Let's express our thanks to God in every way we can. Lord, show me how I can make a tone of thanksgiving unmistakable in my life. January 9th. Our Infinite God. Oh, the depth of the riches both of the wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are His judgments and His ways past finding out! Romans chapter 11, verse 33. The saying, "the bigger the better," is not always true. We don't necessarily need a larger house. A more robust dinner may not be healthy. A longer to-do list? No, thank you. An increased mortgage? That's going the wrong direction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.